There are two types of astrobotany. The first we know well, the idea of transporting Earth plants into space and growing them in places like the International Space Station. The second is the idea of searching for the signature of photosynthetic life elsewhere in the cosmos. As far as growing plants in space, the idea goes back to Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, the father of modern rocketry in the early 20th century. This was further expanded on by Gavril Tikhov, who experimented with plants in space environments, but also pioneered astrobotany in an alien life context. Astrobotany is useful if you want to go to space. It's one thing to maintain an outpost, as we do with the ISS, but a constant supply of food must be launched and sent to the astronauts inhabiting it. This is not an ideal state of affairs for a permanent presence in space or Mars. Rather, growing your own food is. But the ISS and other platforms have been testbeds for growing edible plants in space to significant success. But it's different. Growing a plant in space means that it will be subject to different stressors from the different environment. These include obviously zero or microgravity, but also radiation and other stresses. These have actually been shown to cause genetic changes in plants grown in space. They actually respond on a molecular scale to these conditions. The first actual experiment with plants in space was in 1946 on a US-captured V-2 rocket, but it was actually sort of anticlimactic since the seeds were not recovered. The first returned samples were corn or maize seeds later that year, followed by cotton and rye seeds. The main interest here was radiation exposure and what it would do. Apollo 14 took a wide variety of tree seeds around the moon, and these trees were subsequently germinated. And there are many moon trees in existence to this day, and they grew normally. The first actual plant life cycle in space was on the Soviet Salyut 7 space station, and they actually flowered and produced seeds, showing that plant life can be sustained in low Earth orbit. Skylab experimented on rice, along with many experiments on Mir. There have been many others, including tomato seeds flown on the space shuttle and then distributed back to schools on Earth for growing. And on Expedition 44 on the ISS, romaine lettuce was grown and eaten by astronauts in space. They even got a sunflower to bloom on the station. Another aspect of growing plants in space beyond food, however, is something equally important: oxygen. There have been ideas floated since the 1950s of the idea of using algae to produce oxygen in a human plant life support system for a spacecraft. This is a twofold issue. Not only do plants produce oxygen, but they also scrub carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, which is as necessary as oxygen production in a sealed environment for human life. But there's more. Waste recycling is another area where plants can be of great service. Here, progress experimentally has been slow, in part because you need a lot of plant life to produce enough oxygen, and our current spacecraft and station are rather small. A Mars colony, however, might make better use here, because you can grow a lot more by building bigger spaces. And there's always the possibility of GMOs, where you can increase the efficiency and tailor them to alien environments much easier than selective breeding can do. You'd have to wash the Martian soil to use it as a growth medium, though. It contains undesirable chemicals such as perchlorate, but once you do that, it should be able to be made into a medium you can grow plants in. There's even a plan to use the Martian moon Phobos as a resource moon, where you could mine it for water and use craters as the bases for growth chambers. Hydroponics and LED lighting systems for growth are also on the table here. One interesting aspect is that by studying plants in space, you can determine what factors in their growth are due to the environment they are in versus what factors are built into their genetics and makeup. You can do that to a degree on Earth, but space provides an interesting environment to do this. In 1983, it was shown that sunflowers still essentially behaved the same in their early life cycles even in zero gravity. But other experiments show that some plants can sense the direction where gravity is coming from, even at very low microgravity. Some plants, such as white spruce seedlings, actually exhibited better growth in some respects in space than they do on Earth. The future of plants in space seems bright, and they will no doubt be essential companions as humans explore the solar system and beyond. Animals less so, though it is possible, and animals have been sent into space. There are ideas such as cultured synthetic meat come into play, plant-based alternatives, and so on. Only when gigantic O'Neill cylinders come into play could you consider raising livestock, but even then it may never be worth it, because by that time, cultured meat will probably be a superior product. A well-marbled steak as we know them is probably going to be outdone by a perfectly marbled ideal steak every time from synthetic means. Though of course there will always be those that prefer not to go that route. But the big question here is this. If plants are so efficient and arose so early, photosynthesis began 3.2 to 3.5 billion years ago on Earth, is there some inherent advantage to plant life, or an extraterrestrial analog of it, that through convergent evolution it might be a very common second step for life on many worlds throughout the cosmos? The answer is probably yes. A plant, in some ways, is a natural solar panel that takes advantage of the radiation of a star. Stars are everywhere, and they provide a free and easy source of energy for life, though within limits. This gets into convergent evolution, where certain bioforms in general are favored by certain environments, such as sharks and dolphins looking similar in form, despite very different evolutionary paths. Their shapes just work well in water, which may be common to many worlds. As a result, you might expect to see familiar general shapes in some alien flora and fauna, and leaves might be another example of this. The shape of the leaf will be different, but the general idea might be there to collect light efficiently. That's assuming, of course, that photosynthesis itself is common to many worlds. We don't know that it is. Where this is going to vary, however, is in star type. Different stars are going to present different energy profiles for plants to use. So while Earth plants tend towards green, that's only because of the radiation profile of the sun. It emits most strongly in green light, which Earth plants reflect rather than use. They focus on red and blue light instead. It's interesting to wonder if plant analogs around analogs of the sun are also green. Likewise, foliage on planets orbiting red and orange dwarfs are thought to probably trend towards black, whereas those around an F-type star might trend towards yellow or even blue, which is a rare color for flowers of plants on Earth, much less foliage. Imagine a world bluer than Earth, with the same blue oceans but augmented with shades of blue on its landmasses, in the orbit of a larger, hotter star. Maybe a super-Earth with a thicker atmosphere, maybe even hazy with a stronger magnetic field. Maybe we could detect such a world, with its atmospheric disequilibrium of gases. We once did this, at least in principle, as proof of concept. The Galileo spacecraft, in 1990 during a flyby of Earth and gravity assist maneuver on its way to Jupiter, took measurements of Earth. A group of scientists, including Carl Sagan, did a control experiment to see if they could determine from an instrument package if life was indeed present on Earth and detectable from space. It very much was. They found that methane on this world was in very severe disequilibrium from where it should be on a run-of-the-mill lifeless exoplanet. That disequilibrium is a clear biosignature. Life is creating that. But they also found that in wavelengths of red light, Earth showed a very sharp change in how it reflects light. Galileo saw that most light in the visible spectrum was absorbed by Earth, but shot dramatically up as you got into the red spectrum. This is called the red edge, and Earth showed it unequivocally. Due to their cellular structure, plants on Earth become like mirrors at these wavelengths. There's no guarantee that this happens with exoplanets, but again, as a matter of convergent evolution, it might. And this red edge should be detectable from a distance, though it's possible that it may occur in different frequencies. We can look for this in the light being reflected off exoplanets, and infer that there are analogs there of plant life on Earth, especially if oxygen is in disequilibrium. It would be 2 points based on what we know of Earth in which to suggest that there are plants on that world. But this idea of reflectivity goes much further, or at least hypothetically could, and might even be a feature of life in space itself. Science fiction has envisioned spacefaring organisms before, but never all that realistically. Think the crystalline entity from Star Trek The Next Generation, or even complex spacefaring organisms that are born, live, and die in space. But the reality is that would be very hard for biology to pull off. Indeed, we need a whole lot of technology to go to space, and without it, we don't last long. No air, no human, no heat, no human, etc. Some life on Earth has proven resilient to this, however, space tardigrades and microorganisms, and even suggestions of panspermia through bacteria hiding in rocks blasted off planets during impacts. But in the world of speculative science, the idea of a space-borne organism was seriously contemplated by Freeman Dyson. The idea is an organism evolving originally in the ocean of an ice shell moon, but moving upward through the fissures in the ice to reach the airless surface of the moon, and begin to collect solar energy as a kind of analog of a flower. The roots are in the ocean, and the foliage blooming through the cracks in the ice. He further thought that such organisms could break with the ocean and become spacefaring, perhaps finding asteroids as a source of nutrition. While highly speculative, one feature of a Dyson sunflower is a very high mirror-like reflectivity, directing a star's light to a central point for collection, in which case this would be a highly reflective organism. And if there were enough of them in a star system, that might be detectable as a kind of biosignature, or for that matter, an apparent technosignature from a distance. Who knows what's really out there? Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently lamenting the plants. While I look forward to spooky October, it's always sort of sad at the end of summer to see the plants in such sad shape. I like to grow tomatoes and peppers, and they're peaked for sure. Not out for the count yet, just peaked. Especially since I've been using them as a food source all summer, like a von Neumann probe devouring an asteroid. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.